We'll be discussing four different technologies today that have been used to detect deception. First, let's talk about the polygraph. The polygraph's been in use since the 19th century as a way to measure physiological arousal associated with deception, but it isn't a lie detector. It's just a device that measures the way the body reacts when it's assumed that someone's lying. It measures physiological changes in blood pressure, respiration, and electrodermal activity, or sweating. The polygraph you've seen in TV shows and movies with the paper readouts has been replaced with a computerized version. There are many active polygraphers in the U.S. The largest organization, the American Polygraph Association, says on its website that they have 2,500 members. There are really four purposes of the polygraph. It's used in criminal investigations, in pre-employment screenings, in existing employee screenings, and in sexual offender testing. It has certain advantages. First of all, it acts as a deterrent because people believe it's a lie detector, and so they're less likely to lie when they're being polygraphed. It also encourages confessions. Since people think that it can tell when they're lying, they might be more likely to tell you the truth and confess to their criminal activity. It also makes the public feel safe. Because we believe that they work, we feel safe when someone passes their polygraph. There are different approaches to the polygraph that are used in different ways depending on the purpose of the test. The first is what's called the comparison question test. There are really five phases to a polygraph interview. First is the pre-interview stage. This is where the polygrapher asks questions that are going to be asked during the polygraph so that there aren't any surprises and they know what the answers are likely to be. Second is what's called the simulation test. This is when you show that it really works. You prove that it's 100% effective and accurate in terms of detecting deception. The third step is called the formulating question phase. And this is when there are neutral, relevant, and probable lie questions asked. The neutral questions are questions that nobody would really get excited about. The relevant questions are questions that are relevant to the interview. And the probable lie questions are the questions that just about everybody would actually lie to. An example of a probable lie is something like, have you ever taken something that did not belong to you? Just about everybody should answer that question as a yes. The fourth step in a polygraph is the actual test, and then the final step is the scoring of the test. Innocent subjects should react more strongly to the probable lie questions than the relevant questions, and it's the opposite for guilty individuals. They should react more strongly to the relevant questions and less strongly to the probable lie questions. People have critiqued the comparison question test, though, because they say it has a weak theoretical foundation, that it isn't really grounded in any theory that would explain why people would react one way or the other. They say that there's a lack of standardization in the questioning and scoring, that not all polygraphers use it the same way. And the fact that you have to deceive in order to do it causes people questions, too. The test is not actually 100% accurate, but in order for it to work, you have to convince the person who's taking the polygraph that that's true. The final critique is that it's vulnerable to countermeasures. Countermeasures are things that you engage in that would increase your physiological response to the probable lie questions. Countermeasures tend to be fairly effective in beating the polygraph, things like biting your tongue or tensing your foot, or you can engage in mental countermeasures like counting backwards, or thinking about something frightening that might make you give a response that you shouldn't really be feeling. But is the polygraph accurate? The CQT is vulnerable to false positive errors, which means people who are telling the truth might be shown to be liars. Examiners sometimes use non-polygraph data to make their judgments, which means they maybe are deciding truth or guilt based on nonverbal cues or verbal statements rather than the physiological data that they see in the polygraph. When you look at accuracy scores, examiners tend to be about 90% accurate on guilt or innocence, but their scores themselves are only about 70% accurate. And when independent examiners, without any extra information, they just look at the polygraph chart, they are only about 55% accurate. Polygraphs about a specific incident are more accurate than non-specific incidents, which is why people have moved to something called the guilty knowledge test, or the GKT. This test uses an orienting reflexes approach. They say that you have certain reflexes that cause the physiological changes that you see in a polygraph. But you have to have information that only the guilty person would know, so it has limited applicability. Orienting reflexes are stronger when an item is significant, because some information is ignored or not remembered. So is the GKT polygraph accurate? Well, unlike the other test, it's vulnerable to false negatives, but few innocent subjects fail. Accuracy is about 76 to 88% accurate for guilty subjects, but closer to 94 to 99% accurate for innocent subjects in lab studies. But the accuracy has been shown to be lower in field studies, and it's also vulnerable to countermeasures. In general, the polygraph is probably the most reliable tool we have when asking about specific issues, but it depends on the examiner. So if you're interested in more information about the polygraph or accredited schools that offer polygraph training, check out the information on the American Polygraph Association's website at polygraph.org. The second tool I want to talk about is a voice stress analysis. Psychological stress affects voice characteristics, and we've seen that several vocal cues can be reliable indicators. So it stands to reason that we should be able to use technological tools like voice stress analyzers or a layered voice analysis to detect deception. Typically, voice stress analyzers have microphones that collect voice data, things like the intensity of the voice, the frequency or the pitch of the voice, the harmonics or micro tremors of the voice. Manufacturers of voice stress analyzers have done an excellent job marketing them to law enforcement and other agencies. They claim that VSA devices work as well as the polygraph with greater accuracy, less training, less invasiveness, less cost, and greater immediacy of findings. You can see the handout available on the website voicestress.org that shows the sad truth about them. They just don't work. In 2007, Damphousse and colleagues conducted a study in cooperation with the Oklahoma Department of Mental Health and Substance Abuse Services. They questioned 300 arrestees about their recent drug use. They could establish ground truth about whether they were telling the truth or not because they had urine samples to test for the presence of drugs. Only 15% of those who lied but failed the drug test were detected. And 8% of those who told the truth and passed the drug test were detected. Overall, the VSA is no more than about 50% accurate and does not detect deception any better than the flip of a coin. The third technology I would like to talk about is thermal imaging. A warming around the eyes is indicative of a fight or flight response, but there are individual differences in this response, and nervous, stressed, or excited people can fail the test, so more testing is needed. A very interesting experiment on thermal imaging was published in the journal Nature. It was a mock crime experiment at the Department of Defense Polygraph Institute. They obtained these images before and after lying in reply to the question, "Did you steal $20?" And you can see the difference. They claim that the thermal imaging lie detection has an accuracy comparable to that of the polygraph and has the potential for application in remote and rapid screening without the need for skilled staff or physical contact. Another study by Warmalink and colleagues in 2011 at an airport interviewed passengers and asked some to lie about their upcoming trip. The thermal imaging detected more arousal in liars because liars' skin temperature rose significantly during the interview, whereas truth tellers' skin temperature remained constant. On the basis of these different patterns, about 64% of truth tellers and 69% of liars were classified correctly. While this is certainly better than flipping a coin, it means we still have a long way before we throw the polygraph out. The fourth technology is brain scanning technologies, fMRI or EEG. Functional magnetic resonance imaging, or functional MRI or fMRI, is a neuroimaging procedure that measures brain activity by detecting associated changes in blood flow. It measures blood flow to various regions of the brain. And since lying is more cognitively difficult than telling the truth, there's an increased prefrontal parietal activation during lies. Electroencephalography, or EEG, is the recording of electrical activity in the scalp. In a study conducting EEG that I did with some colleagues, we saw that people who called themselves good liars showed less cognitive effort than people who called themselves unskilled liars. Are these practical for field applications? Probably not. You can't really set up an fMRI machine in an airport. Langelben in 2008 reviewed different studies of fMRI for lie detection and said that even though there's an increased prefrontal parietal activation observed in most studies across experimental paradigms, accuracy ranges from 73 to 93%. In practice, the accuracy of fMRI is likely to vary, though, with the questionnaire type, countermeasures, and other variables, and so it definitely needs more testing. Today we've talked about four different types of technological aids to help us detect deception. the polygraph, voice stress analyzers, thermal imaging, and fMRI or EEG. The polygraph is certainly the most widely used and can have excellent accuracy when used in situations testing specific knowledge. The voice stress analyzer is the most controversial because while many agencies have been buying them, the research evidence suggests they do not work any better than chance. The thermal imaging and brain scanning technologies have promise. They're probably only useful in certain situations and require more testing. There are other promising technologies out there as well that I have not discussed, but I guess we'll have to wait and see what the future holds for them.